And you are supposed to join along and sing with us as soon as you know how to do it. May the affirming light of this Christ candle guide this flock of believers. May the gifts of this community and the love of God be a blessing, and may the flame's warm glow be a beacon of welcome for all people. I'll keep working on this while y'all sing.
To you to get happy, right?
Present with us. joy. Notice your surroundings. What are you sitting on? Do you smell anything? What do you hear? See? What do you feel? Taste? And again, we're going to breathe in, and this time I want you to say, God is in God's holy temple. The words are on the screen. And then breathe out. Let all the earth be silent before God. Breathe in. God is in God's holy temple. Breathe out. Let all the earth be silent before God. God is in God's holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before God. One more time. Breathe in. God is in God's holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before God. Close your eyes again if you've opened them. Let your mind's eye view the earth as a temple of God. Imagine others around the world also being silent in the presence of God. Feel their camaraderie, their friendship, that they also are following the spirit of love. God is here with us, and together we are gathered in Jesus' name. Let's pray a prayer for the church by Reverend Emily Swan. Spirit of Jesus, come with fire that refines, water that refreshes, wind that topples, breath that fills. Kindle a global revival of empathy, justice, and active peacemaking. Birth a witness of love that is bigger and better than we inherited. Liberate us from privilege and oppression. Unshackle the gospel from nationalism, colonialism, white supremacy, and every other lens that shrouds the good news. Give us an abundance of grace for others and ourselves. Grant us compassion for those who suffer. Free us from the influence of money, power, and acclaim. Restore our reputation for caring for the poor, loving our neighbors, being ambassadors of peace and stewards of the earth. Unlock the immense resources. Encourage us so we do not grow cynical, isolated, and burnt out. Fan our hopes, our joys, and our connections. Allow us rest when we need rest. Enable us to see you in each person we encounter. Show us mercy in our humanity. Let us love more fully than we thought possible. Let us not be quick on the draw, ready to retaliate, escalate, assassinate. Let our collective fervor for justice eclipse institutional concerns. Let us trust and follow the wisdom of those who have been marginalized. Let us persevere in creating safe places of worship to eat bread and drink wine together. Let us stand for love and with love, following the way of your Son as best we're able. Let us not fear an experiential spirituality. Let us listen to the wondrous bodies you gave us. Let us hear your voice and tangibly feel you with us. Let us discern your guidance. Let us abide in and with you. Show us what you're doing so we can work together. Move where you will, when you will, in whatever way you will. Come, Holy Spirit, and restore your church. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is found in Voices United, number 389, God is Here. The words will be on the screen, or you can read them from the hymn book, number 389, God is Here.
Pray.
hand stream. All good? Thumbs up all the way across. Who's got the same teacher as last year? Anyone? No? Everyone has a new teacher this year? You have the same one as last year? And what's your teacher's name? Miss Druin? Druin? And what grade are you in? Are you going to school for the first time ever? The first time ever? How exciting is that? So how many days did you get to go this week? 2 days? 3 days? 2 days. Awesome. Master, what grade are you in? 4. And grade 8, Emerson?
7.
7. 6. What grade are you in? 6. 6, 2. And the 6-year-old is in grade 1? Good one. And what grade are you in?
4.
4. Awesome. I wonder if any of you have had a quiz yet. Has anyone had to do a quiz at school? You had to do one? What was it on? Math? Any quizzes, Emerson?
Spelling.
Spelling. Well, I have a quiz for you today because it's our first day back for Sunday school, so I thought maybe we'd have a quick quiz. So I want you to raise your hand like we're at school if you know the answer, okay? How many of each animal did Moses take on the ark with him?
Oh, Emerson, every time.
It wasn't Moses that built the ark, right? It was Noah.
Right.
Okay. You're supposed to raise your hand, buddy. And I wasn't going to ask it because I knew you'd catch me. Okay. Question number 2. Are automobiles mentioned in the Bible? What do you think? You don't think so? Anybody else have an idea? Do you have a phone in your pocket, Emerson? Okay. I wanted you to Google Acts chapter 2, verse 1. From the King James Version of Acts chapter 2, verse 1, it says, "And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place." And you know what? My first car was an Accord, a Honda Accord. So, but really, I don't think that's what the Bible's talking about, right? There's no cars in the Bible. Okay, so those were trick questions, but I have one more. According to the Bible, can 1 + 1 = 3?
No.
You think so?
Yeah.
Well, according to the Bible, Jesus says, "Wherever 2 or 3 are gathered, I am there." So if there's 1 or 2 people, that makes 2 people plus Jesus, so there's 3. So there's 2 + 1 + 1 = 3. And I don't know how many people are here today. Jake's my counter, and he doesn't tell me until the end. But there's this many people here plus 1 because Jesus is here with us today too. And I know you're going to learn more about that in Sunday school. But before you go to Sunday school, I'm going to invite my friend Janelle up here. And she's going to give a little presentation with your help. So if you're comfortable, I invite you to turn or come and sit up here and turn around if you're okay. But if you don't want to look at the crowd, that's okay. You can stay in your seat.
Seaman, you can do it.
Anyone want to come and help Janelle? You don't have to if you don't want to.
Yeah, okay. So the Sunday School wanted to say a big thank you. So each month, at the end of the month, we do our Sunday School collection, and our congregation gives a donation to us. And so we wanted to share what we've been doing with our outreach. So our first one, do you want to stand up so we can see that? So Seema has, we had our Sunday School picnic. So the kids and their families joined us at our house, and we had a pool party, and we had lunch together and enjoyed the afternoon together. So that was one of our outreach. Stay down. So Nazarene and Scott, we had our Wonder Camp Vacation Bible School, so the Sunday School helped with that as well, and thank you to the congregation for helping with all those expenses. Next, we've got our Tractor Sunday Lunch. So for those of you that were here, people drove tractors, thanks to those who drove for us, and we had music that day, we had lunch together, and so the Sunday School put on the hot dogs and oh yeah, beans. We had hot dogs and beans, and so the Sunday School was able to do that thanks to you guys. And then next we've got the Strawberry Social Outreach. So Strawberry Social, we were doing that fundraiser to help with Grace United Church as they are working towards bringing Seema and Celine and Nazarene's cousins here. And so our Strawberry Social event, our Sunday School actually paid for the expenses so that we could give the full $1,100 to Grace. So that was one of our outreach. And lastly, what do we got here?
Easter card outreach.
Okay, so our last thing we did was earlier for Easter this year, we all worked together hard to do some cards, and we gave those to all those shut-in and those that are at a distance from us, and we mailed them or we dropped them off thanks to some of our helpers, and we just touched base with those people. So anyhow, that is our Sunday School wrap for this year so far. We say thank you big time for doing all that for us, and we look forward to starting up Sunday School today.
Within the community, and it's also allowed us to buy new curriculum this year. So last year I wrote all the curriculum to match what was happening here in the worship service, which was a lot of work. So this year we've purchased some curriculum from Illustrated Ministry, which looks awesome, and we're really excited to share that with the students. And we're also have a new plan for the older ones, the youth. We're not only having them come the first Sunday of the month to watch a movie together, we're inviting them back on the third Sunday of the month to stay in worship and then to meet with me for pizza after worship so we can discuss the sermon and maybe I'll get some help and critiques, and we'll just sort of work through the scripture and the sermon. So anyone who's really moved could join in or take a turn in that discussion with us. That's the third Sunday of the month. But before you get to Sunday School, we as a congregation would like to bless you in your new year at school. So the blessing of the students is responsive. I'm going to invite you to read the bolded part, and we'll work through this together. But this is for all of you students. We bless you this morning. So, loving God, we ask your blessing on these students who have just begun another school year. May they find the courage and humility to be both student and teacher, knowing that we all hold wisdom to share. As they renew friendships and forge new relationships,
may they be blessed with laughter. May they build connections that bring goodness to themselves and to their communities.
Loving God, we ask your blessing on these students as they break bread together in the form of snacks and lunch.
May they be blessed with their nutrition they need for their growing bodies and with food for their developing souls.
Loving God, we ask your blessing on these students as they are challenged in classrooms this year.
May they be blessed with a caring teacher. May their hearts remain open to the stories told
minds and deepen their love for the world. In the stress of deadlines and assignments, may they remember that their worth is not measured by grades alone. May they embrace the process, the questions that lead to even more questions.
May they experience moments of challenge and grace, laughter and learning as gifts.
Loving God, we ask your blessing on these students as they share sports and games.
May they be blessed with good coaches and learn the benefits of healthy competition, of challenge, of teamwork.
Loving God, we ask your blessing on these students as they learn to research new topics and search the internet for information, for facts, and for fun.
May they be blessed with wise eyes. May they approach each day with a spirit of wonder, ready to engage, explore, and evolve.
Loving God, we ask your blessing on these students.
May they return home with the blessing of parents,
loving God, may these students find your blessing and your presence in the ordinary, in the routine, in the everyday, and
may they always remember that they are enough and that they are so very, very loved. Amen.
Amen. As they are making their way out, I invite you to stand and sing together this blessing, Child of Blessing.
Preserve my life through your righteous ways. The second reading is from Matthew 18, verses 15 to 20. If a fellow believer hurts you, go and tell him. Work it out between the two of you. If he listens, you've made a friend. If he won't listen, take one or two others along so that the presence of witnesses will keep things honest and try again. If he still won't listen, tell the church. If you won't listen to the church, you'll have to start over from scratch. Confront him with the need for repentance and offer again God's forgiving love. Take this most seriously. A yes on earth is a yes in heaven. A no on earth is a no in heaven. What you say to one another is eternal. I mean this. When two of you get together on anything at all on earth and make a prayer of it, my Father in heaven goes into action. And when two or three of you are together, because of me, you can be sure that I'll be there.
Thanks, Eli. Let's sing together hymn number 325. Christ is made the sure foundation. Caught my eye, and I gasped, and I let backwards as fast as these little legs would take me. It was a snake, right there, curled up in the bush. I nearly passed out from hyperventilating, but I didn't scream. It was an eye-opening experience, one that made me stop short and reconsider my entire new foraging witchy hobby. I may need to change my approach. I'm hoping that you might have a similar reaction to today's scripture lesson, minus the pounding heart and gasping for breath, more just the part about a change of perspective, that perhaps there's more here than just some berries on a bush. Because when I first read the scripture today, I wasn't overly impressed. I had Eli read it to us from the version of the Bible called The Message, which uses modern language. The last verse he read said, "And when two or three of you are together because of me, you can be sure that I'll be there." That isn't quite as offensive as the more familiar version from the New International Version of the Bible, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there. What is the gospel writer talking about? I thought God was always with us. I've said it for the last few weeks in a row that God is before us, behind us, beside us, and within us. So why is the scripture now telling us that God is with us when two or three of us are gathered? What about when we're alone? Well, Old Testament professor at Queen's Theological College, Bill Morrows, used to regularly quote his past minister by saying that the presence of the Holy Spirit is often an inverse proportion to the number of people present. What the heck does that mean? Well, it means that as the number of people decrease, so from a congregation of 100 to a class of 10 to a group of 2 or 3 or to being alone, the presence of the Holy Spirit is actually increasing. That's a snake in the bushes. Interesting way to look at it. Or from author Liz Auld, managing editor of Crosswalk.com, who said that the scripture verse, "where two or three are gathered in my name," actually is talking about the ancient verses from Deuteronomy, where taking one or two people with you adds up to one or two witnesses who can testify to your attempt at reconciliation. Because remember, at the beginning of the reading, that was about if you have a disagreement, try to work it out with that person. If you can't, take one or two others with you to try to talk it through. And remember that even when there are two or three of you, God is with you as well. There are different interpretations, different understandings, different theologies about scripture, and the United Church of Canada celebrates that. That is one of the things that makes our denomination unique. It's that we have many communities of faith with multiple theologies, multiple understandings of God and God's relationship to the world and to the church. And that's a bit about what we're going to dive into over the next several months, this fall and through the winter, using this book, Undivided Love, Navigating Landscapes of Living Faith, by theological educator and United Church minister, Reverend Janet Gear. Together with five other congregations from across Southern Ontario, we're going to explore the question, what are we called to do whilst navigating our different thoughts and beliefs about God and Scripture and nurturing our various longings and unique gifts? And we're going to look at that through the lens of our living faith. That sometimes words fail us, language complicates our thoughts, but there are times when faith expresses itself not in a neat and tidy statement or in creeds and confessions, but in pauses and queries. Those, "let me try to put it another way," or "perhaps it is more like this," or "ah, there's a snake in the bush and maybe I need to slow down and reassess," kind of moments. Gear writes in her book, "Words are never the first language of faith. Life is. Life is our starting point. Faith is always at the heart of the way we live as the children of God, the way we walk in the way of Jesus, sanctified by the Spirit who gives us life. The Christian faith is an incarnate faith, a faith in the creator of a living creation, one embodied in the people of Israel, incarnate in the person of Jesus, and animated in the living church. It is a faith that lands first in matter, in the body. The Word becomes flesh and is known in the way our lives carry it, individually and corporately as a group. So the question, what do you believe, is a beautiful echo of the question, how do you live? If we go back to the Gospel of Matthew and we hear the example, if a fellow believer hurts you, if you have a disagreement with someone, how do you live? Do you flip him the bird? Do you become a keyboard warrior posting something mean and scathing online? Do you start plotting against that person? Or do you do as Jesus calls? Go and try to work it out. If that doesn't work, take a witness or two with you. Because in that, in each of those scenarios, the Holy Spirit is there too, working for good. And in the end, we may not come to a consensus, but we can lovingly disagree. Our congregation here houses multiple understandings of who God is, or even what we mean when we say God, and multiple understandings of God's relationship to the church and to the world. Over the coming year, I hope that we will not only build stronger connections within this congregation, but also be better equipped to articulate our own theology, our own words about who God is and where God is leading our church, better able to express our living faith and thus what we believe. Our lived faith is what determines which prayers we cut out of the Sunday bulletin and save, or to which blogs or podcasts we subscribe. It determines which sermons or anthems speak to us, even with which minister we connect. Lived faith is behind why we might prefer serving the refugee committee or joining the worship committee or vice versa. It determines which webinars we attend and which books are by our bedsides. It might even determine whether you seek solace in the garden, regularly give blood, or write to your local member of parliament. These micro actions of lived faith have to do with the particular contours of your own faith. So just as we ask God's blessing upon the students in our family, may we ask for God's blessing. May we also be blessed with the light of curiosity and truth of love to guide us this year. May we recognize one another's wisdom and honor our uniqueness and differences. May we be courageous and forge new relationships and be blessed with laughter and grow together. May we be open. May we be open to new things and to change, to snake in the bushes moments that could redirect our trajectory. May that be our living faith, that God is our constant, our rock and redeemer, before us, behind us, beside us, within us, always with us when we are gathered for glory, no matter how many of us are together. And in the words of Sarah Bessie, may we intentionally come together to cultivate hope and love right in the midst of the dumpster fire of our present days. Let's pray. Holy God, would you be both strength and comfort for us here this morning? When the world is like a dumpster fire, where the imbalance between rich and poor among your people is like fire and water, where some have whatever they want and where others have little of what they need. Almighty Creator, you came and dwelt among us and taught us to love, and yet today your people are divided and hearts are broken. Politics draw lines between us on immigration, guns, and climate change. All the isms that have been fought against for years have seemingly multiplied. Racism, sexism, heterosexism, ageism, classism, ableism. We need your strength and your comfort, God. May we each have a friend in these days that knows us, knows our heart, that calls us out and calls us in. May your strength fill us with endurance and perseverance to shine your light and to share your love, Holy Mystery. Guide us to where we are needed and help us not to give up, to stand against the injustices of this world, to take up space wearing your armor, standing in your authority and dignity because we were made in your image. Help us to claim that and own that. Give us courage to live like that so that others will see and know that we are believers, that we are Christians by our love, our fierce love that comes from you. We pray, God, this morning for hope, that those who are lacking in hope might find it in a good friend, in a kind nurse, in a stranger's smile. We pray for those who are grieving, those who are lonely, those who are struggling physically or mentally or socially. We pray for those who are away from home, navigating newness. We pray for those parents whose children feel so far away. We pray for all the single parents who do it alone and for those who have partners and still feel like they're doing it all alone. We pray for those in new relationships and struggling relationships and those who are navigating new and stressful situations. Holy God, we pray for this church family, for those who are here this morning, those who are away for whatever reasons. We pray for those in nursing and retirement homes, those who are convalescing at home, for those whose concerns we know about, and for those who keep their prayer concerns private. We pray for all who are listed on the South Cayuga Community Church prayer list, and in a moment of silence, we bring before you all the people, places, and situations we hold close to our hearts this morning. Loving God, we trust that you are here with us in this sacred space with all these people and that you are with us when we are talking to you alone, washing the dishes or out for a walk or kneeling at our bedsides. We trust that you are with us always and that you hear our prayers and know the innermost longings of our hearts. Thank you for your presence with us, for your comfort and your strength, and for the gift of the Son Jesus, the perfect example of love, of how you would have us live. As a mother hen gathers her chicks under her wing, Jesus gathered his friends and disciples and taught them to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let's take a quick look at the announcements. The worship committee is meeting tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. Lunch Bunch is trying something new this week. That's on Tuesday. Everyone is welcome to join us. We're having a potluck this week, and we're going to Linda and Bob Simons. Thank you for offering your space. The address is there, but if you need directions, see Linda or Bob after church, and bring your favorite dish and a lawn chair. Hopefully the weather is right on. Not too hot, not too cold, no rain.
It's going to be perfect.
It's going to be perfect. And then you can have lunch in on Wednesday too. Just bring your lunch here. The UCW will meet at noon, and their meeting begins at 12:30 with the Thrifty Dresser. They're coming to give a presentation. And then next Sunday, the fundraising committee is meeting after worship, and then official board will meet on the Tuesday night following. We'll talk about birthdays in a minute. One announcement that isn't in there is that Flo has a sign. I would just like to thank everyone who came out on Friday night to the tricycle races in Cayuga. There was lots of support. It was a really great night. I'm sorry I didn't win. I had high hopes. Next year, I'm coming back stronger, and I'll do my best. Are there other announcements? Linda?
I just have to say that it was exciting. We've gone several times to the great tricycle race at Haldeman Motors. And it was exciting to have somebody participating that we knew. So that was our excitement and our pride. She just kept on going and kept on going. It was great. Thank you.
Thanks, Linda. Are there